HarperCollins Australia presents Flesh Made New, The Unnatural History and Broken Promise of Stem Cells by John Rasko and Carl Power. Performed by John Rasko. Acknowledgements. This book was a long time coming and changed a great deal along the way. A decade ago, we convinced the scientific committee at the Brochet Foundation, Switzerland, that the world needed a popular work about stem cells, and that we, a physician scientist and a philosophy nerd, had the wherewithal to write it. Our proposal led, in autumn 2011, to a brief, blissful residency on the shores of Lake Geneva. Though the book we began there bears little resemblance to the one you are reading, without the generous support of Brochet, we'd have no book at all. As the medical potential of stem cell research has been celebrated often and to excess, we decided to do something different. Instead of looking to the glorious future that stem cells promise, we began digging into their somewhat murky past. We wanted to tell the history of stem cells, warts and all. Along the way, however, we were surprised by how many warts we encountered and how deeply rooted they were. Some of the more egregious examples had made the news. A case of scientific fraud here, a case of medical malpractice there. But they were treated as isolated incidents. It slowly dawned on us that, on the contrary, they were signs of a general malady affecting stem cell science and medicine. Diagnosing it gave our book a new purpose and a more polemic style. We are thankful to Jessica Reed from The Guardian for allowing us to test some of our views on a broad international readership. Our 2015 and 2017 Guardian articles about the scandals surrounding the Japanese researcher Haruko Obokata and the Italian surgeon Paolo Macarini not only provided materials for chapters 8 and 11, they also helped us figure out what our book was all about. In 2018, John was invited to deliver the 60th annual Boyer Lectures by the Australian Broadcasting Corporation, a task that Carl assisted with. Entitled Life Re-Engineered, these talks provided another public forum in which to rehearse our ideas. We are grateful to the ABC for this opportunity, and more particularly to Ian Coombe and Joe Gelanese for producing the lectures. A fortunate upshot of working with the ABC was to make contact with HarperCollins at just the right time. By then, the book was half written, and we had a pretty good idea of where it was going. Good enough at any rate to score a publishing deal. We have high praise for the folk at HarperCollins. We especially thank Mary Rennie for her patience and careful guidance throughout the publication process. Thanks also to Madeline James and Emma Dowden for their expert editorial assistance. Over the years, we have benefited from discussions with many people. Our thanks are due to Don and Dottie Thomas, John Davis, Harry Lochte, Rainer Staub, and Bob Epstein for sharing their memories of the early years of bone marrow transplantation. Doug Sipp for his insights into the Obokata scandal. Pierre Dallaire and Patricia Murray for dishing the dirt about Macarini and his associates. And C. Glenn Begley for explaining the problem of perverse incentives in science. We are also grateful to Christine G. for her sage advice on the art of publishing. We are deeply indebted to Marta Koch and Sonia Pemberton for reading a draft of this work. Their comments and criticisms have been enormously valuable. They helped us improve every page and saved us from innumerable errors, oversights, obscurities, and stupidities. Any flaws that remain are entirely our responsibility, of course. As we hope to revise and republish this work in the future, we welcome any post-publication feedback. Writing this book has been a marathon effort. We couldn't have done it without the help of friends, colleagues, and family. We've both been blessed with excellent support teams. In particular, our heartfelt thanks go to Simon Strasser and Gabrielle Tobias, our significant redheads, for the countless times they have offered us a sympathetic ear and sound advice. Although our book often dwells on the mistakes and misdeeds of stem cell science, we aren't doomsayers. Nor do we wish to discourage any budding young scientists from pursuing a career in this field of research. On the contrary, we share the common hope that stem cells will one day prove themselves effective in the treatment of a wide range of medical conditions. Unfortunately, stem cells have attracted a surfeit of hope, indeed an unhealthy excess. Hype does more harm than good and stands in the way of genuine progress. Only by deflating it can we properly appreciate both the therapeutic promise of stem cells and the scientific effort needed to fulfill it. That's the optimistic aim of our bubble-bursting enterprise. If you come away from this book disillusioned but not discouraged, then we've done our job properly. Introduction. Great expectations. We're obsessed with science and technology. Obsessed with the possibilities they bring. Each generation seems to nominate one or other innovation as its preferred gateway to the future. Through it, we channel our hopes and fears. The mid-20th century was nuclear. The power of the atom was, by turns, transforming the world for the better or threatening to destroy it. When the Cold War ended and the fear of a nuclear Armageddon subsided, we watched the rise of the computer and joined the information age. The biological side of information also captured our attention. We fell under the thrall of genetics, then biotechnology more generally. With the Human Genome Project, 1990 to 2003, deciphering our genetic code, it looked like we were learning the very language of life and that we'd soon translate this knowledge into therapeutic wonders. Everything changed in 1999 with the death of 18-year-old Jesse Gelsinger. Jesse was one of the first people to receive gene therapy, and it killed him. Gene therapy was sunk on its maiden voyage. We were suddenly in need of a new favourite, a new kind of biotechnology. Fortunately, stem cells were at hand. Stem cells are the master builders of your body, generating all of your tissues and organs and helping to sustain them throughout the course of your life. Your body has a limited ability to repair itself after disease and injury. Some of your tissues regrow, others just scar. But whatever regenerative powers you do possess come from your stem cells. At the end of the 20th century, stem cells took hold of our imagination. We began to dream of harnessing their healing powers. Since then, we've been told time and time again that the era of regenerative medicine is upon us. Stem cells will soon cure just about every ailment under the sun. Think of a disease starting with A, AIDS, Alzheimer's, arthritis, autism, and then work your way through the alphabet. You name it, stem cells will fix it, even COVID-19. And if you need a new kidney or liver or windpipe or heart, you'll be able to grow them with stem cells. Not today, perhaps, but tomorrow, or the next day, or the day after that. Salvation, it seems, is always postponed. Yet we keep on hoping. Each disappointment gives us a fresh opportunity to renew our faith in stem cells. And since the future lasts a long time, there is always room to reschedule. But rather than turning our eyes once more to the horizon, hoping to catch a hint of the coming dawn, perhaps we should dwell on those disappointments for a moment. And perhaps we should stop to consider whether we've expected too much, too soon, from stem cell research. It's fine to be hopeful. Hope is an essential part of life. Without it, no one would strive to develop new therapies, much less submit to them. But excessive, misplaced hope is unhealthy. It results in bad science and worse medicine. This book offers something of an antidote to stem cell fever, a salve to soothe the itch for salvation. Our approach is historical because hype tends to encourage amnesia. It fixes your attention on the future rather than the past, the latest rather than the long term, the breakthroughs rather than the deep continuities. Hype frames each discovery as a game changer, a fresh start, a reason for looking forward, not back. So instead, we'll take you on a series of tours into the history of stem cell research and cell science more broadly, pausing along the way to consider general topics such as the notion of scientific genius, the ethics of animal experimentation, and the effect of competition on research. We should warn you, however, that this is a scandal-prone history, replete with all the things that the hype merchants prefer to ignore: the blunders and setbacks, confusions and delusions, secrets and lies that have compromised cell science and stem cell research more particularly. That said, there is nothing post-truth about our book. We're not skeptics when it comes to science, and we don't mean to encourage those who are. On the contrary, precisely because we are committed to the scientific project, we think it is important to acknowledge that it often fails to live up to its own high ideals, and this for a simple reason. It's a human activity, and we humans are prone to hubris, deceit, greed, prejudice, stupidity, laziness, and more. To that extent, we muckrake in order to help clean up the stable of science. Trouble is, when it comes to stem cell research, there is a lot of muck to rake. Not that we ignore the scientific successes in this book. We'll describe some in detail, but we'll describe just as many scientific scandals. That's because good and bad science are joined at the hip. Here's a better analogy. The invention of the steam train was also the invention of the train wreck. Something similar can be said of every scientific and technical advancement. In the first part of this book, we'll give you a couple of examples that fuse good and bad science together. They are drawn from the prehistory of stem cell research, which is to say, from the discoveries that led to its emergence. Talk of stem cells began in the late 19th century, but they would have remained hypothetical creatures without the invention in the early 20th century of a technique known as cell passaging. Its inventor was Alexis Carrel, an eccentric figure who earned both high honours, including a Nobel Prize, and harsh criticism for supposedly being a Nazi sympathiser. Part genius, part charlatan, Carrel is the patron saint sinner of this book, The Scientist We Love to Hate. In Chapter 1, we recount his most notorious experiment, which opened up the possibility of studying life under glass, in vitro, then blocked the path forward for the next half century. Carrel's train wreck had hardly been cleared from the tracks when another was discovered. Not an experiment gone wrong, but a cell culture gone wild. Chapter 2 tells the story of the cancer that killed a 30-year-old mother of five, Henrietta Lacks, only to live a life of its own in labs around the world. Dubbed HeLa, it has been more widely studied and more scientifically useful than any other cell culture. By the same token, none has been more monstrous, quietly contaminating other cultures and ruining a vast amount of research, which is why HeLa is both the darling and the despair of cell scientists. In the middle of the book, we meet the pioneers of stem cell science and medicine. Don Thomas, for instance. In the 1950s and 1960s, he helped invent the first and best ever stem cell therapy, bone marrow transplantation and its variants. Nowadays, we take it so much for granted that we can hardly imagine the difficulties that Don and others contended with, their slow, stumbling progress, the dreadful risks they took, the long years of failure, and the many patients and lab animals who died along the way. This is medicine at its most heroic, and as we show in chapters 3 and 4, there is nothing glamorous about it. In case you find yourself wondering why stem cells are hardly mentioned in these chapters, it is because...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.